Thanks a lot, Bill, for that great talk. I'm interested in the piperine example you gave, just because it's the most common thing people have on their, everybody has piperine on their table, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So what is the typical dose that would be required to elicit that effect, and how relevant is that to the amount that most people consume?
Yeah, it's a great question. And the fact that you put, if you're like me, I'm a pepper freak. I love black pepper as well as crushed red pepper. But the amount of black pepper that you just put on your food to season it, there's not enough piperine in there to do anything. We're talking about concentrated extracts of piperine where you're looking at in the neighborhood of usually north of 100 milligrams of pure piperine to elicit some of these. Most of the piperine that's added to some of these, there's actually a product called bioperin. That has, I think the piperine concentration is around 250 milligrams, so it's a pretty whopping dose. The amount of piperine that's just in black pepper, spreading it on your food, minuscule. So that's probably not an issue, but the issue is some of these extracts of black pepper and piper and longum that are found in a lot of multi-component supplements. So that's a great question.
Great talk. Really enjoyed it. So tell us a little more about this use of golden seal to mask urine screening. I didn't follow that story.
Yeah, you know, that was brought to my attention by some folks. And so I started looking into the literature. And, there's actually quite a bit. I won't say quite a bit. I mean, you can actually find some articles on that. And so exactly why golden seal? Well, if you look at it, I mean, depending upon whether or not a lot of the opioids are involved. And so a lot of opioids have to be metabolized by 2D6 to be active. And so if you can inhibit that with golden seal, then that may be a good thing. But it also may be a bad thing because it may actually, if it's a prodrug or not a prodrug, it depends upon, you know, if you inhibit the prodrug, then that may be a good thing. You might mask it, but but it depends upon whether or not some of the opioids are metabolized by 2D6 to active components or whether they're not. And so, by inhibiting 2D6, that can either make some of these more easy to detect or some less easy to detect. And that's the mechanism. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Bill. Barbara Sorkin from ODS.
Nice to see you,
great
Barbara.
Talk. Thanks. I was thinking, wonder if we could switch gears a little bit and talk about component interactions within specific botanicals and thinking about the potential for different effects of caffeine within coffee versus guarana versus yerba mate. And what about caffeine in energy drinks?
That's a great question. I'm actually working on a large fairly exhaustive review on caffeine-containing dietary supplements that it's not quite ready yet, but it's getting there. But if you start, it's a great question because if you delve into the literature, most of the, at least the, I like to use the ephedra-free supplements because they offer a great example for how other phytochemicals can potentiate the activity of caffeine. And we talked about the catechins, which are present, which that's kind of a, I don't know, it's a no-brainer, but it's something that's certainly there. But a lot of, say for situations, there's a lot of products that use coleus forskoli or forskolin, which can certainly potentiate the activity of caffeine because it stimulates adenylate cyclase and stimulates the production of cyclic AMP. And if you get into all the G-protein coupled stuff, that can certainly increase it. Activity. The incorporation of yohimbe and yohimbine, again, caffeine and yohimbine, bad combination. And then even with red pepper or capsaicin, some of the capsaicinoids can actually have they can stimulate cardiac activity. And so when you've got caffeine by itself is pretty innocuous, but when you start looking at it in terms of other components that can stimulate its or it can facilitate its activity, it turns a lot of these seemingly innocuous caffeine components into some pretty heavy-hitting drug products for that matter. And so you talk about the issues with the energy drinks. Most of the components that you find in most energy drinks are things like taurine and glucuronolactone, and they may have a little bit of an effect, but for the most, the big problem with energy drinks is, one, they have a lot of caffeine, and two, they're easy to drink, right? And particularly the shots, okay? And thus the name, shot, okay? And so when you consume caffeine in a shot, that caffeine gets in your system very quickly, and you'll feel the effects, you know. You will have the five-hour energy, you know, and so on and so forth. But the problem is that people think, oh, well, one of these is fine. You know, they're sold out there with the Advils and whatever else of the world. Boom, you start hammering back three or four of those things. The next thing you know, you're getting close to caffeine toxicity. And then a lot of these products are also marketed to be used in conjunction with vigorous exercise. And so down in Arkansas, where I'm from, when you start getting into the late summer and football season is around the corner and you start getting into two-a-day practices in the heat, and a lot of these kids are taking Red Bull and Monster and Rockstar, and because they're easy to drink, and they think that it's kind of like Gatorade, but it's nothing like Gatorade. And so then you've got a lot of this caffeine in your system, and the caffeine and vigorous exercise in the heat is a very bad combination. And so that's why you start to see... That's why the number of emergency room visits related to caffeine since 1990 has increased by a factor of 4 or 5. But there are a number of components that are inherent in a lot of natural caffeine sources that can stimulate the activity of the caffeine. But also, there's some purposeful formulation. I think it is purposeful formulation with some of these components that are known to stimulate the activity of caffeine, and that's why you find them in a lot of products, particularly some of the unique energy drinks, but more so in a lot of these ephedra-free dietary supplements. That's a great question, Barbara.
Great answer. Thanks.
Bill, thank you so much for your stimulating talk. Thank you again.
Thank you.